everybody, and welcome, Thomas. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Thomas Hinnerheim, who's a professor at the University of Waterloo, and also is working at the Institute for Quantum Computation there. So Thomas has been a pioneer in these free space quantum communications. He initially worked in Vienna, also worked in industry, and so has been also pioneering electronic systems and sensors, optical sensors. And in general is interested in quantum communications, mainly for quantum key distribution. And in Canada, he's now leading a project to bring these experiments to the space with satellites. So thank you very much for having me telling us about your work.
Great, thank you. So, good morning, everyone. Thanks for the great introduction, so I don't have to introduce myself any further. That's very nice. So I've been in Canada since 5 years now. I'm actually from Austria. And but it's always great. Thanks for bringing me back to Europe for 2 days. It's great. So as a small introduction into the topic, because my main interest is this long-distance quantum communication using photons, I wanted to just have a really quick intro into where photons come from, just to remind all of us. So it was the photon concept, which is this energy discretization of the electromagnetic radiation, right, was discovered a little more than 100 years ago when people noticed this problem with the black body radiation, that it didn't match up the theories of the day, right, the classical theories, and where Max Planck introduced this quantization concept he called it an act of desperation, but it turns out that in the end this was the way to go, right, in order to explain the observed spectra. Solid state pointer, yes, thank you. So then it's very famous, the history, right, in the sense that then later on Albert Einstein in particular then showed that he put a solid underlying sort of theory under this kind of hypothesis from Max Planck, and he compared the black body radiation with an ideal gas, where in the ideal gas it was very well known at the time, it's about particles moving around statistically, and he from the comparison he was able to show that the only way out is to conclude that the black body radiation is also made up of particles in that black body, right? And that led to this a solid proof that the light consists of photons, the light quanta. And the very famous sort of experimental proof then later was this photoelectric effect, where, as we all know, right, photons hitting some surface can emit electrons, but only if the photon energy is above a certain threshold, which was related to this Planck's constant, right? And then the electrons that emitted will receive a certain kinetic energy depending on this photon energy, right? And since there is this was the kind of the current of electrons, or the energy of the electrons versus the frequency of the photons, and there's a clear cutoff, a threshold where the signal starts, and under this photon, if the photons have less energy than this threshold, then there's no electrons. So this was the first clear evidence from an experimental point of view that photons are here to stay, so to say. The concept is more than just a theoretical concept. The other reason why I like to show this also is that still to date, most of the photon detectors we have, and I'll discuss that a little later, are still essentially based on this effect, right? Light radiation, so the photons come into a system, typically a solid state, like a semiconductor, and release photoelectrons, which will then be amplified, for example. But the underlying principle is still pretty much the same. So that's very nice. And then in the early days of quantum mechanics, right, people like Erwin Schrödinger, who were very famously involved, discovered that quantum mechanics also has features which are counterintuitive, and one of them is this superposition, and it's a very famous concept where, in the end, quantum mechanics, as Schrödinger would put it, one of the essential features of quantum mechanics is this superposition and also entanglement, and he called it the essence of quantum mechanics. So the superposition principle, right, which states that a particle is in state A or B, was discussed a lot at the time, just based on by discussing this kind of simple double slit type of system, right, and there was a lot of debates whether somehow one could get interference and the path information at the same time. Quantum mechanics, as we understand it today, does not allow that, right? And this was people like Schrödinger and others were saying that only if we cannot know which path the particle took, then we will see the interference at the end of this at the output of this interferometer or double slit diffraction pattern. And however, if one tries to do a measurement of which path the particle took, then the interference would disappear. And this was considered sort of at the day classically, this would not make sense. It only makes sense in the sense of quantum mechanics, where this quantum state describes sort of say all the knowledge out there about the quantum system. And the extension of quantum, the superposition, to more than one system, more than one state, is entanglement, where, for example, for two, this would be two photons, for example, the superposition concept can apply here, where two photons can be in this correlated state of one horizontal, the other one vertical, or in a superposition of the first one vertical, the other one horizontal, right? That's one of those famous Bell states. And this quantum entanglement, of course, even further pushes this concept of the counterintuitive, or shows even stronger these counterintuitive features of quantum mechanics. The way I view entanglement is that it's essentially the same thing as superposition, only over a more complicated system, right? Expanded. What I find very interesting is that these very philosophical and fundamental discussions roughly 100 years ago, or almost 100 years ago, today lead to this concept of quantum information or quantum technologies, where we define a qubit, right, which is an extension of a classical bit, such as a switch being in either on or off state, and the qubit is this extension where the qubit can be in two states at the same time, right? The superposition on and off at the same time. And of course, this quantum information would bring us new applications for processing information. You know, quantum computing is a big example, quantum communication, actually also other, like quantum random numbers, for example, is another application. So this is sort of now leading into this application aspect. So if we now look at photons, how can photons carry this quantum information or these qubits? I mentioned one already, which is this polarization state, where if we use the two polarizations, such as one horizontal, the other one vertical, we can associate one state with a zero state, the other one with the one state, for example. So this could be our qubit. It's interesting to know that polarization, then, if we think of the superposition of a qubit, the 0 plus 1, now in polarization, that would mean I have a linear superposition of H and V, and this would correspond to a 45-degree linear polarization state. So it has a very nice, in the sense of classical, light beams, it would have a very nice correspondence, and of course at the single photon level, single photons can take these polarization states. Now, if we look at the measurement of such a polarization state, quite often we would use polarizing beam splitters, like a polarizing beam splitter cube, for example. Now, what it means is that if a horizontal light beam comes in, it may come out always at the, let's say, at the zero arm, for example. And if my measurement analyzer is aligned perfectly with the basis of the transmitted polarization state, in this case, the horizontal, and those two outcomes correspond to horizontal and vertical, I will always get, you know, for one photon after the other, always a consecutive zero in this case, because it's the gives a well-aligned output. However, if my measurement was oriented at, let's say, 45 degrees, let's say my polarization measurement is still in the horizontal vertical basis, however, my light source now emits 45 degree photons, right? So in this qubit, in the diagonal basis for the qubit, now suddenly, according to the way superpositions are defined, I will get a random sequence of zeros and ones, because there is, in this case, when the basis of the measurement is perfectly misaligned, so to say, from the original basis, so it's usually unbiased, then I get a random output of where I can find the result. So, and for this quantum entanglement, I mentioned again, for example, this is one of these four Bell states, so it's called the singlet state, quite often in analogy to the spin 1/2 equivalent. So the photon one is in horizontal, the other one vertical, or vice versa. Now, the interesting thing of this entanglement is that the quantum mechanics, as of today, has no limits in there for this quantum entanglement. For example, in the sense of how long it would live, at least in principle, or how far apart the particles can go. Right? They can be separated. Like, when this is an example to illustrate what's going on, I could represent those entangled particles as dice, which are, you know, they're spinning around. And I could separate them by an arbitrary distance across the universe, so to say. And if one of them falls and shows a certain number, then the correlated other die would also show the corresponding number, for example, right? They'll always be correlated. Albert Einstein, who himself noticed this kind of feature of quantum mechanics, there's this famous Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paper, the EPR paradox, as it was called, in 1935, where they noticed this is actually a consequence of the formalism. He called it a spooky action at a distance. He said, well, this is, he used it actually as an example of why he thinks quantum mechanics doesn't make sense, so it's not, he called it not complete, something is going on here, in a way, right? Whereas today, it turns out, with all the experimental evidence we have, it's quite the opposite, right? We'd say quantum mechanics is working really well, it follows this kind of strange behavior, right? It's all in there. That is very exciting. The reason I also like to show this is, and motivate this a little more, is that these quantum entangled particles can also be used, are an essential feature for quantum communication. Right? The testing these quantum correlations for entanglement is quite often done with a so-called Bell test, Bell inequality, where the Bell inequality is very interesting because what Bell managed to do in a famous paper in 1964 was to say, well, he was studying this kind of quantum correlations of particles emitted of the source, and each of them sent to its own measurement, right, and an analyzer, this one aligned at alpha, giving a plus and a minus output, or the other one at beta, giving a plus minus output. And what John Bell found is that if he assumed the particles would pick up some information, some stored information at the source, and then as they travel apart, they have no further communication or interaction. So he would call that a local hidden variable, right? So the particles just have a certain amount of information stored inside them. And that the measurement that they perform, so when they're exposed to a measurement, the particles would then decide, based on this local hidden information, which outcome to take, so right, which output of the analyzer to take, depending on alpha. Then the correlations between the one particle and the other, measured in this correlation parameter, for example, if I look at four different combinations, they would always have to obey a certain bound. This is a limit, right? And so this is an inequality. So no matter what combinations of alpha and alpha prime, beta prime, the experimenter may choose, or the experimenters actually, so one side and the other side, the correlation should obey this bound. And quantum mechanics violates this bound, right? So it is the famous CHSH inequality, which is a slightly more advanced version of the Bell inequality. The classical bound is 2, and quantum mechanics, the correlations would give us 2 times square root of 2, right, 2.82. So it clearly violates this limit. So what it means is that these quantum features truly are counterintuitive in the sense that we cannot describe in some way what is happening here, because particles which are far apart can then, one way out would be, well, the particles have to communicate, right? That's one way to this, one could get around this. One could say, well, even that they're separated, far apart, somehow there's something going back and forth. However, as I'll point out a little later, experiments have separated photons by hundreds of meters, if not kilometers, and the setting choice can be done very quickly, randomly, and still the photons will show this violation. So what it means is that even if there was a communication, it would have to be superluminal, right? It would have to be faster than the speed of light. And that also gives us other problems if we would assume that. If we give up the reality concept, that's even harder. That would mean then it's even less clear what to, then we can't say anything anymore about the physics that's going on in some sense, right? So that would be a more tricky concept. So this is anyway very interesting and shows very nicely the true mystery of quantum mechanics, I think, where we have a nice mathematical also distinction between what classical physics would, our intuition, so to say, would do versus what, in the end, nature, how nature performs. So after this kind of precursor or introduction, I want to now shift into the actual application. And so the topic that I'm very interested in and that I'm going to present today is this quantum communication, and in particular quantum key distribution. So quantum key distribution was developed in concrete terms in 1984 by Charles Bennett and Jill Brassard in a nice paper, 1984, which appeared in a proceeding from a conference in Bangalore. And the underlying concept is that if I want to share a key between two communication partners, Alice and Bob, they want to generate a secret key in order that they can do a secure communication. Now, the idea is Alice sends individual photons from Alice to Bob, right, and prepares them in certain quantum states. Since she's using single photons, because of the quantum features of those photons, an eavesdropper called Eve cannot do any form of measurement or manipulation of those particles because this will show up just because of the principles of quantum mechanics, such as think of Heisenberg uncertainty, for example, right? It's not possible for a single particle to obtain all the state, the full quantum state, for one particle. That's just not possible. Another way to see it is that they're using the no-cloning theorem, where which also states in quite simple terms, actually, that it's not possible in quantum mechanics to make a perfect copy of a quantum state, right? So then this kind of underlying feature inherently protects the full information. So what Alice and Bob then have to do after the transmission, so Alice sends a whole bunch of those photons, Bob will detect a certain fraction of those, and after the transmission they can then compare their data, they can compare a subset, for example, and determine the errors on the transmission. And so, and then from the error rates, they will be able to determine if there is a secure information or not, right? And roughly, the threshold for this error is around 10% that can be accepted. So, So this started in 1984, and then not too much happened until 1990s, and that's where the field really gained momentum, and that's nicely shown in this plot here, which is out of a review paper from people at NIST, Alan McDowell and others, where they actually it's a review of single photon sources and single photon detectors, but they showed how the numbers of papers in this field has grown over the years, right? And please note, this is a logarithmic scale, and at least for one decade, it was almost linear on this logarithmic scale, so there's a true explosion of activity. And now about quantum cryptography, but also related technologies such as single photon detectors, single photon sources, there's been a huge amount of activity. And now it's kind of leveled off a little, but it's still a very massive amount of activities, right? Like hundreds of papers a year in these areas. So it's a very live and active field. So the generalized scheme for a BB84 setup, as it's called, is the following, where Alice, the transmitter, has a quantum source, and this is most typically would be either a weak coherent pulse source, as it's called, WCP source, or an entangled photon source based on parametric down conversion. So those two schemes I'll describe later on. And then there will be a quantum channel for transmitting the photons with maybe, and the quantum channel will have certain characteristics like transmission loss or polarization errors, transmission errors. There will be background noise, and then a receiver at Bob, for example, a polarization analyzer, and then finally we have photon detectors, and those detectors also have a certain characteristics like efficiency, dark counts, and other properties. And so today my plan is to discuss the key elements of such a system, and show you some examples of implementations. That's the plan for the day, for this session. The Bennett-Brassard protocol, the BB84 protocol, let's quickly run through it. So the key elements are that for the quantum transmission, so Alice will create random signals in these polarization states, like plus minus 45 horizontal vertical, and Bob will do random measurements in either this basis, the diagonal basis, or the horizontal vertical basis. And so then what happens is that Alice will first randomly transmit polarized photons, and it's important that she chooses randomly for each one independently a different setting. Bob will then also randomly choose a certain polarization measurement, and will then get a certain outcome depending on his respective measurement. And so what you can see is that, so let's take the second one first. If Alice sent, in this case, vertical, Bob measures in the horizontal vertical basis, then he will get the correct outcome, right? A vertical photon. And whereas, and the same for diagonal, right? Alice sends a diagonal photon, Bob happens to measure in the diagonal, gets a diagonal. However, in the, like in the first example, if Alice sends diagonal, Bob measures in the horizontal vertical, then there will be a random outcome, right? There will still be an outcome. The photon is not absorbed in the analyzer, but it just is random. So then Alice and Bob start a public discussion, and they will determine by comparing, just talking about which bases they both chose, right? They can find out which events belong together. So in this case, they only keep the ones where they happen to use co-aligned bases, and they discard the rest. So on average, that will be, say, half the events. And those ones they can keep. And then this this is called a sifting process, so to say. And then they will associate two of the polarizations, say, with a zero, the other one with a one, let's say. And it's one of the diagonal bases and one of the horizontal vertical. Let's say those two are zero and those two are ones. And then they can determine that, well, this event has to be a one, this one will be a zero. And of course, Alice knows which actual polarizations she sent, and Bob knows what he actually received, but they don't disclose that information. They only talk about the bases. So in the end, they will get their same string of ones and zeros. And now what they would do in the next step is they would look at the transmission of errors, and by looking at a subset, for example, let's say they have a million such bits in a practical scheme, they could look at some percentage of that which they actually share in the part of the post-processing, and then you can get an estimate for the key error. So the question is now, why is this secure? And to show that this is secure, let's assume the one of the simplest type of attacks an eavesdropper could do, which is, let's say, the measure and resend attack, right? Let's assume the eavesdropper does a measurement here with a polarization analyzer, essentially representing what the Bob analyzer does, and then depending on the outcome, will then generate a new photon with the corresponding measurement result, right? So that could be the simplest strategy. Now, if we look at the polarization states, we now also have to consider what Eve would get, and we can look at the same choices that, let's say, Alice sends those events. Now, the eavesdropper also chooses, just like Bob, has to choose randomly a certain setting, because the eavesdropper, just as Bob, doesn't know what basis will be chosen, right? So there will have to be a certain random outcome. It's not necessarily random, but if the eavesdropper will get a certain outcome and will get random events in the case that the basis is misaligned with Bob's, right? So Bob will still do also his random measurements and get an outcome. Now what happens when they enter the sifting process, same as before, public discussion, and they would end up with you choosing the same kind of events in this example. However, now the eavesdropper will introduce some problem. Why? Well, in the case that that the eavesdropper's basis was misaligned with Alice's basis, right, then the eavesdropper will create a new photon, however, at a wrong polarization state, which will propagate to Bob, and Bob will then get a random outcome. So what it means is that in the end, after the whole sifting process and so on, that Alice and Bob might still choose the same events, however, the eavesdropper will introduce some fraction of wrong events. And in this kind of simple type of scheme for resending and sending, and for measuring and resending, the eavesdropper will actually, on average, produce 25% error rate into the transmission, just by this simple measure-resend attack. And this gives an indication of why this can be secure, only up to a certain error rate. Right? Now, of course, the security proofs themselves, they assume more clever attacks. There's different types of attacks also. And then that's where this bound of closer to, let's say, 10% applies, right, for such kind of systems. So where is QKD technology today? So research activities have worked at distances in optical fiber up to about 300 kilometers, and clock rates up to 1 gigahertz are sort of happening now, so where the transmission rate for ALICE. There is a commercial system, actually quite a few years already, which is available, such as from ID Quantique in Switzerland. There's a lot of other companies involved which are working on such kind of systems. Not necessarily all of them have commercial systems available. However, there is quite a bit of commercial or at least industrial interest and industrial research. Right? In particular, Japanese companies are very active also. In Europe, there's this Toshiba Labs at Cambridge, for example, which is very active. So there's a whole range of activities. QKD networks have been shown now already in several locations. Why is this interesting? Well, QKD itself is typically a point-to-point type of link, and what those QKD networks are trying to do is to demonstrate the viability of let's say covering in a city. You want to connect several nodes, and they showed several point-to-point links across a fiber optic network on a city. There's been a couple of such networks. The latest one around the city was in Tokyo, 2010, actually. But there's been a couple of others. So the newest type of research is also, or activity is, to do long-distance repeated node, trusted node repeaters over long distances. So one is done by Battelle in the US, which is actually one of the industrial partners of ID Quantique now for the US, and they have demonstrated are working on a 700 kilometer link around the area of Washington DC, and they're actually planning at least a trusted repeater node across the United States. And also there's been an announcement from the Chinese groups about a 2,000 kilometer trusted node link connecting Shanghai and Beijing. And those are all sort of in the works and in progress. The other interesting thing to mention is that there is a group working on standards for QKD as well. That's one of the problems for making QKD truly sort of industrial and also commercially viable would be to have proper standards. And there's this European Standards Association for Telecom Systems, ETSI, and they are actually, so for a couple of years already, they're very actively trying to work on standards for that. So this is roughly where the systems are. So let's go back a little and look at the technology. So one thing to wonder about or to consider for such a QKD system is always what are the rates that can be achieved in the end. And so in simple systems, one would consider rate formulas similar like this, where I have a certain amount of events, certain number of events emitted from my source, and now from there, there's, I have to consider several losses in the system. For example, what is the efficiency? Now, eta is always the efficiency of my source, for example, to actually emit the photons or to capture them. Then I have the bulk's polarization analyzers and so on, right? So that will come into some efficiency. Over a more realistic quantum channel, I would also have to consider, well, what is the link transmission has to come in, right? And so on. But also I might have a certain number of background counts which add in here. And since the background would be a noise signal, right? So that will actually be crucial in providing imposes a limit for how far, for example, the transmission goes. Why? Because the efficiency of the link drops over distance, right? The further I'm going to go, the less signals arrive, and then at some point, this background signals will take over. So important to notice is that after sifting, so Alice and Bob have a certain amount of events where they had the correct settings, and the Q-bar, then the quantum bit error ratio, will measure how many of the events that Bob actually received in the end, how many of them were wrong. Right? That's what's the Q-bar, the definition of Q-bar. So this is now taken out of one of the recent review articles on QKD, on the status of QKD. What they did there is compared a couple of schemes for encoding these quantum states. The what's called here one photon would be the typical sort of the original BB84 scheme based on a single photon, in truly single photon at the emitter, and it follows roughly this kind of behavior, and this would be the transmission probability measured in decibels, right? So it's a logarithmic scale. And typically, so what they assumed here is sort of typical parameters for the quantum sources, the channel, and also noise of detectors. And what we can see is that in those examples, at around 30 dBs of transmission loss, the key rate in the end drops close to zero, right? It just means that's the limit where the noise of the system takes over and you don't get enough signals anymore. What also happens actually in a real system would also be what is called finite size effects, where I simply don't get enough signals across anymore in a given time to do the statistics. That's another problem, right? It's called finite size effects. So what we can also see is some different schemes. So that would be the idealized one. If I just had a weak coherent pulse like a laser, I have to take into account the double emission events of such a laser. I'll talk about that in a moment, due to Poisson statistics, and that puts actually a hard limit on the transmission loss. That can be overcome by using what is called decoy state QKD, where one uses weak coherent pulses. However, one imposes different intensity levels, and in that way, you can find out if an eavesdropper is trying to apply a beam splitter attack or not, and so then one can recapture the transmission distance again of that is expected for the one photon case. The other one to mention here is the entanglement based QKD, which I'll also mention later, where by using an entangled photon source and essentially sending one of the entangled photons to Bob, and Alice measures the other entangled photon locally, in that sense, it also performs very well and actually is very close to the idealized state as well, or situation. So that's also very promising. So let's look into it a little more specifically, how photons can be used for quantum, for these qubits. We mentioned polarization already. The other scheme that is widely used, in particular for fiber experiments, is time bin, where I have, in time, I define two time slots, one called a zero, the other one a one, and those can be used as a qubit, right? So the photon will be either in the first or the later slot of time, or in the superposition of the two times. Right? People have also used frequency as an encoding. It's somewhat the same as it's connected to time, of course, but explicit frequencies have been used. And for example, this was an experiment where there was two frequencies involved, omega 1, omega 2, and one could show, let's say in this case it was entanglement between two photons entangled in those frequencies. Spatial mode is also used, and what the idea is that it's been noticed a lot, right, and there's a lot of experiments also, that a beam propagating in space has a lot of modal sort of degrees of freedom. And one example are these Laguerre Gaussian modes, like this one here, where it has a helical phase structure, and the singularity in the center causes the intensity to drop. This is often also called a donut mode. However, they can be nicely used to encode quantum information, actually also even in higher dimension. Or believe it or not, a simple sort of kind of interferometric scheme can also be considered as a qubit, right? Where if I denote, like say, in an interferometer, one path as the zero, the other one as the one, I can do certain operations and so on. And in some way, this is also like can be used as a qubit, right? What it means is the photon is either in this path or that path or in both. And lastly, I would like to mention there is a continuous variable type of schemes for encoding quantum information. Essentially, one can use the quadratures of light. Now, this is like multiphoton states. However, one can use the quadratures to also encode quantum information. And there's also been some work on QKD using continuous variables. For my kind of work or interest, continuous variables is not as applicable. That's why I also won't mention it too much today. And the main reason is that for long distances, for where we have high transmission loss, continuous variables are not as suitable as the single photon or discrete variable cases. And that's why for my line of research at the moment, this is not very interesting. However, I do want to point out, it does have very interesting properties and features, at least for shorter distances, because the detector system and the source system can be somewhat simpler, maybe, than in a single photon case, and also it has more resilience against background noise, for example. So daylight operation or operation in fibers which have illumination could be interesting. So now let's look at the quantum channels. There's two main methods for sending photons. One is free space, and here we have an example of an experiment we recently did around from our building. You can see a laser that was sent from the roof of our building to a nearby road, or optical fiber, right? Optical fiber, well known. This, by the way, is about 100 kilometers of fibers on spools in the lab. So if we look at a free space propagation, what happens is there's a couple of effects which have to be considered. The first one is essentially diffraction. Now what this means is that one has to notice that even a simple beam operating sort of prepared in the lab and propagating will always have a natural divergence, right? There's no way around that. This is just in the simplest case, one can consider this as for Gaussian optics. This is a plot that I took from this nice textbook, Fundamentals of Photonics. So such a beam is characterized by a certain beam waste, right? The kind of the most narrow section of the beam, and from there on it will diffract. And when I'm sort of significantly far away from the sort of inner part of this beam waste, it will essentially diverge at a linear cone almost, right, with a certain divergence angle. which is a measure of the, in the end, is the ratio of the wavelengths versus the beam diameter at the center. And the interesting thing to notice here is that it doesn't matter how large this beam diameter is chosen, there will always be this non-zero divergence, right? So in a way, in the lab, we would often talk of collimated laser beams. In the end, there's no such thing as a perfectly collimated beam which keeps going forever. Any collimated beam will always diverge at some point. Another way to see that this is happening is that any form of optical system, like a telescope, will have a natural resolution limit. And this is due to the same physics in the end, right? The resolution of optics comes from diffraction. So if we take this kind of beam waves into consideration, in the most simple term, now ignoring any sort of atmospheric effect and so on, it would mean that if I send a laser beam or an optical beam of photons from out of a waste at a transmitter into towards a receiver of a certain diameter, right? I will always get a transmission probability which has such a behavior where I have the product of the transmitter diameter, receiver diameter squared, divided by the length and the wavelength squared, essentially, right? And this is a very basic fundamental formula. There's no way around that one. We have to live with it. The thing, though, to notice is, and this is what makes, in the end, satellite communication viable, is that the transmission loss only scales quadratically, so to say, with the distance, right? Or 1/4 quadratic. It's not exponentially or some other transmission sort of behavior. So that is actually a very favorable transmission. Now, of course, this is all outside of atmosphere. Now, once we're in atmosphere, we have to consider that there is always diffraction also going on. Turbulence due to small changes in the fluctuations in the air. What is happening is that the air, since it's moving and there's temperature differences and so on, there will be different pockets of air next to each other which have different a slight variation of refractive index, 1-to-1. So it's a very sort of a statistical type of scheme, and it's measured with this kind of CN squared, which measures the size and distribution of those packets. In the end, one can break it down and look at by integrating over the profile of this. This structure profile, in the end, one can determine what is called a free parameter, R0, which can always measure the quality of the atmospheric turbulence for any given pass, right? Because I'm measuring over the whole path length. And now, this R0 is kind of convenient because what it does is it gives us an idea for how much the beam will diverge after passing through atmosphere, and in the sense that we can think of this being the kind of diameter of a transmitter telescope, right? So now, if you think back, the divergence of this Gaussian beam depended on the beam waste, right? Now, if you have a turbulent beam, the kind of beam waste at some distance will then depend on this R0, right? The effective beam waste. So now what it means is that my beam will diverge as if it came out of a small telescope or diameter or optics with a certain diameter corresponding to this R0. Now for typical atmosphere like around a city, this would be a few centimeters, this R0 parameter. In good atmospheric locations like the mountains or where astronomical observatories are, this can be on the order of 20 centimeters, if not more. So it can be larger. What it though does mean is that for
quantum, if I want to send a quantum signal over some distance where pointing of confinement of my beam is the most important parameter, it also means that it doesn't make sense to have large telescopes. There's no point, because if my telescope is any larger than this R0, I'm not really gaining anything in my transmitter quality. And this is in particular interesting for us when we're considering transmission to a satellite. Let's say we have the satellite up here, which will receive our signals, and then the transmitter at the ground, the beam will diverge, and based on this R0, it gives us a limit on how big the telescope is going to be, right? And therefore, at the moment, for sending signals to the space, we're considering maybe 40 centimeter telescope, and that will give us the best we can ever hope for, pretty much. And a larger telescope would only make sense if we had something like adaptive optics, which can correct turbulence. If I have a quantum receiver on the ground, let's say, there, one can, the turbulence will lead to a beam spreading, a widening of my spot. So there it can make sense to have a larger telescope if my detector is large enough. Another problem of atmospheric link is the fluctuation. So this is out of a recent paper where we looked at sending an entangled photon over 1.2 kilometers of a link, and we studied the actual fluctuations. And so here we have the red one is the local entangled, the photon which is measured locally. The blue was the single count rate, the count rate at the receiver after 1.2 kilometer. And green was the coincidences, right? The coincident events. Now here, every dot was roughly a tenth of a second. And you can see the link sort of intensity is going up and down all the time, right? And actually, there's a tendency in this case to be closer to constant, like 2,000 or something, 2,500 events. Actually, that's the background level, right? So we have more population in the background than actual signal. If we look at the distribution of transmission versus probability versus transmission rate, we can see that in a very optimal case, I would have this kind of distribution, which is actually what's called a log normal distribution, right? It's the essentially the logarithm of a normal distribution, where which is considered for a nice sort of atmospheric situation. Now in the extreme, when we have excessive turbulence, this kind of model breaks down. And what we see here is a distribution which looks more like this, where I have a large population at the background level and almost a flat distribution at the signal. So there's a whole variety of things going on. It shows another problem when doing free space links. One link is never going to be the same as the other. Even the same link depends a lot. It all depends on the conditions, weather, wind, and other parameters. So one has to live with that. Well, luckily, the photon-based quantum communication is okay with this, because these fluctuations can be solved and dealt with. So. Atmosphere also has absorption, and this is like a plot of some of the absorption bands, I should say this is the transmission through atmosphere, and you can see there's a whole range of absorption bands due to different atmospheric constituents like either gases, water, oxygen, nitrogen, and so on, and also aerosols plays a role, right? Pollution, yeah. And what we did here, for example, these lines here are some of the lines we considered for in this case for the satellite link, and we looked at the couple of wavelengths which are typical laser wavelengths, right? And at the same time, they're like far away from resonances. They're only kind of overall in these kind of loss. The sort of bound of the losses, the transmission losses, which is due to the scattering, just the scattering of light, right? And that's where this overall kind of curve comes from. It has to be considered as an angle of horizon sort of as well, angle from horizon, that's important for satellite. Now I mentioned already, if I have a receiver, like this is like in this Tenerife experiments, where we had a 1 meter receiver, and if you look at the focal plane, the spot of the light is actually changing a lot, right? This is like small snapshots, roughly like this was maybe one every tenth of a second, roughly, something like that. And it's just fluctuating and changing a lot due to turbulence. So the real trick here is to collect those lights into the detector. So the other type of proton channel that we have is optical fibers. Now optical fiber is a really clever invention where light can be guided in this optical medium simply by having a difference in refractive index between the core, what is called the core, and the cladding. And the way to see how this works is we know from basic physics of optics that there's total internal reflection, right? If you go from a denser material to a less dense material at a certain angle, there will be total internal reflection. No light can enter the other side anymore. So this gives a maximum angle. And this, so there will be a certain acceptance cone, which is also defined as what is called the numerical aperture of the fiber. And it essentially just means that the numerical aperture of the fiber means it is defined by those light rays which can still be kept and guided due to this refractive, total internal reflection, right, from refraction, using Snell's law. So in the end, it turns out this numerical aperture will, which depends on this refractive indices, is essentially a function of the change of refractive index between core and cladding. And typical optical fibers based on glass have a delta of roughly 1 to 10 minus 3, 1 to 10 minus 4 of refractive index, where the main refractive index is like 1.45, 1.5. It all depends on the material. So for quantum communication, normally people would focus on using single mode fibers. Now what that means is a single mode fiber is that when one chooses a fiber where the core diameter here measured, or core radius measured as A, is so small that only the lowest order mode, now this is plotting the mode function of this fiber, only that one is allowed to propagate, right? Now, where does this come from? The mode can be calculated using such kind of out of the Helmholtz equation, right? As it evolves in this fiber, this system, and there will be solutions of this mode function which correspond to Bessel functions. And an important part is this beta here, right? The effective transmission parameter, so to say. Now, depending on the refractive index and the diameters and so on, there will be a certain fiber core diameter where only the lowest order fiber mode can propagate, right? And the higher order modes, such as here we look at the L equals 3 for as just an example, which has this higher order Bessel functions, right, that would require a larger mode index to propagate. I mean, there's lots and lots of textbooks. I took this out of the Sale and Teich textbook again, but there's many textbooks which describe this kind of features. And the other thing to consider for single mode fibers, in particular if it's glass, we have to look at the losses. And this is for silica, a typical sort of transmission curve.
where we have relay scattering on one side, which drops with wavelength, and then it increases again. And this is where the main telecom is, for example, here. The choice of 1550 nanometers for telecom transmission, okay, we'll have a break in a very short moment, yeah. Is done at 1550. Why? Because that's overall the kind of transmission optimum. Another interesting transmission band is the 1310 nanometer, which is in here, this spot where actually it turns out regular glass has a dispersion minimum. And that's also important because pulses will not disperse as much. But the losses are better, not quite as good as at 1550. And 800 nanometer is here, and I have to mention 800 nanometers because for many kind of entanglement experiments, people will still work with 800 nanometers because single photo detections are nice and easy. However, the typical transmission loss is like 1.5 dB per kilometer, if not more. Whereas at 1550, it would be 0.16 decibels per kilometer for the best fibers. Right? Now, if I take this and look at the wavelength that I use, let's say I want to go 100 kilometers of distance. If I choose 1550 nanometer, my transmittance will be like roughly 3%, right, for this fiber, optical fiber. 1310 would maybe be 0.1%. However, 800 nanometer is 10 to minus 15. It's just way out of beyond hopeless, actually. So this is because even though it doesn't seem dramatic, right, this kind of change, the exponential scaling of transmission losses here, it just leads to this dramatic change.
To recap again, the optical fibers right, so we have the capturing of light inside the fiber because of the total internal reflection. Optical rays can be guided very nicely with little losses based on the change of refractive index between the core and the cladding, right? And the numerical aperture of the fiber is then defined as essentially as a relation of this delta, which is the change of refractive index. And for quantum communication, we focus on using the single mode solution. What that means is that the modes that can be calculated for the optical radiation come out of the Helmholtz equation, and the zero order mode, which is this one here, which looks very similar to actually a Gaussian mode as well, and is so the lowest order mode based on these two Bessel functions, and depending on the parameters of the fiber, in particular the core radius, if the core radius is just small enough, only the zero order mode can propagate, and this is what is called a single mode fiber. And the higher order modes, such as this example of L equals 3, they will not even propagate. They will not have a positive beta, where the beta can the propagation parameter is not working. So and in addition, we have to consider transmission losses. As I mentioned, the transmission in glass, in silica glass, has an optimum at 1550 nanometers, 0.16 dB per kilometer in the best case. The core diameter actually is 9 micrometers. Yeah, I forgot to mention that first. And if we compare that to let's say what 800 nanometer propagation does, even though it's only a few more dB per kilometers of losses, however, if we wanted to do a 100 kilometer distance, the transmittance of that fiber would be very, very bad at 800 nanometer. At 800 nanometer is 10 to minus 15, whereas at 1550, we're talking some percent of transmittance. That doesn't mean that, I should point out that 800 nanometer can still be done in optical fiber.
right? For short distances, it is possible. And we've done some experiments up to close to 10 kilometers, and that's about pretty much the cutoff rate in the nanometer. And we'll see in a moment, a little later, when we talk about photon detectors, this leads to a little bit of a challenge. So for transmission, the 1550 is, of course, the way to go, right, for fiber optic transmission. However, for detection, the 800 nanometer is just much better for detection because we can use silicon detectors. So there's, unfortunately, this trade-off one always has to do in the lab when having such a system. This fiber optics have other, so to say, problems one has to consider, such as, I mentioned single mode operation is preferred, right, because of modal dispersion. Chromatic dispersion, so pulses can stretch over time, that can be a problem also for photon pulses, right? They start to wash out and start to overlap. Polarization mode dispersion is important for long distance transmission. What that means is that optical fibers, when they're like, they're never straight, there will be curvature and bending and pressure. That will lead to birefringence in the fiber, so that the different polarization states will have different propagation. And it's like a random birefringence, and that in the end leads to an effective sort of birefringence of a fiber, which can stretch pulses quite a bit actually. And if it's too much, it can even depolarize those photon states. So this can be overcome by having narrowband signals, narrowband photons. And just generally, polarization states will experience a rotation, which can actually change quite fast for installed fibers, depending on the environmental sort of impact, like temperature and pressures and vibration. The polarization states can just fluctuate quite a lot, and that can lead to problems for the quantum transmission. So now if we compare the different quantum channels, like so we have atmospheric channel and optical fiber, and we look at polarizations. So each of those has their pros and cons, right? So polarization, I think the general sort of theme is that polarization works great in atmosphere. So atmosphere really preserves polarization. It's not affected by turbulence and so on. And it's well tested. It also works well in optical fiber, it's well tested. However, in optical fiber, the polarization state changes quite fast and rapidly. It has to be compensated. Time bin, using those different time slots, there is slightly the opposite. It's been used a lot in fiber optic transmission. It's widely used, and for example, like commercial system I pointed out earlier is using a scheme based on time bin essentially. It's not well tested for atmosphere, particularly not for turbulent atmosphere. So it's in the lab, of course. In that atmosphere, it's been done. So that is not studied much yet. Spatial modes of light, it's been done in the lab, but in atmosphere it hasn't been studied over long distance, at least not very well. There is some work going on actually very recently about doing that, but one has to always take into account the fluctuation of atmosphere. In fibers, it's not even clear how to transmit higher order modes in a stable fashion, in a practical way, let's say. There's some work going on, but it's nowhere near as practical as time bin or just polarization. And frequency bin is very similar, has not been studied very, very much, although it should work really well in optical fiber. Continuous variable, works really well in optical fiber. It has simple sources and detectors. And in working atmosphere, turbulent atmosphere is going on, and it does show promising results also, I have to say. It's going very well. However, they do, in general, those systems have the problem of link loss, right? If it's 20 decibels of transmission loss, then they have run into tricky problems, right? So yeah, this is just again a reminder of the different encoding modes that one could continue, that we were considering. So how do we detect single photons? As I was saying initially, it's all based in the end on this photoelectric effect, or I should say mostly, right? The most common detectors are based on that, where photons come in and somehow emit charges or release charges. Now, a very widely used detector is these ones, such as these commercial modules from Axiom. Now, the company is called Excelidas. They're in Montreal in Canada. And they have a silicon avalanche photodiode, which is sitting on, you can see in this photo, there's a little white, you can see the white surface of the square surface of the thermoelectric cooler. So they're cooled to minus 20, minus 30 Celsius inside the can, and they can get very good performance at single photon, very good efficiency, very low dark counts. It's a commercial, widely used commercial system. If one, so that's silicon, and then there's also indium gallium arsenide, and that's the one which is useful for telecom, right? If one needs to do 15-15 nanometer or 13-10 nanometer, one has to go, unfortunately, to a less favorable material because it's more noisy, indium gallium arsenide. Then there's other detectors which are, they've been more on the research kind of detectors, and superconducting ones. One type of technology is nanowires, and the other one transition edges. I do want to point out there's a couple of reviews. So one that I've been looking at a lot is this one by Buller and Collins in 2010. So when you have a detector, you have to consider certain parameters, So Robert Hadfield, in his Nature Photonic review of detectors, defined a figure of merit which combines three of the most important parameters, which is efficiency, dark counts, and timing resolution. Now, why would that matter? It's because if you think about it, in the performance of, let's say, QKD, right, I have to consider at least these three parameters together. I cannot separate it, right? Why? If I had imagine I had a detector of really high efficiency, but a very bad timing resolution, right? My performance might actually be worse than a detector which has a great timing resolution, right? And a not so great efficiency, right? It all depends on the ratios. So this figure of merit considers the timing resolution, detector efficiency, and dark count rate. In many systems, in particular telecom, one might have to worry about after-passing probabilities. Actually, for telecom, that is the limit for the rates in particular, right? Because after-passing can only be suppressed by blanking, so increasing the dead time of the detector. Saturation can also be actually a limitation, right? I mean, many detectors have a limit of on the order of a million counts per second. So if I want to have a QKD system which runs at a million rates, sort of bits per second, then I need to have detectors probably I need much higher saturation levels, so I don't hit this saturation. So again, we don't have to go into any details. This is one of those reviews. This one is from Robert Hadfield, this Nature Photonics. And he looked at a couple of detector schemes and systems that are around them, and in the end judged them by this figure of merit. Here it is, right? In the end, that's the one parameter one can use to identify which detector is the one I need to use for my system. This is some of the commercial devices that are around. I mentioned the silicon APDs. There's a whole range of possibilities. And for indium gallium arsenide, like as I mentioned, for telecom, we have to then switch to other systems where, such as these ones from ID Quantique, and those ones are gated, meaning they cannot have, they need a sync pulse to come to the detector in time of the photon, and then they'll be activated. They do recently, people have managed to develop free-running indium gallium arsenide as well, and but they have slightly less efficiency than those gated versions. So I guess one thing, when the general distinction is, if I want to use a semiconductor-based detector, is my wavelength that I'm trying to aim for. If I use silicon, then I'm limited to, or I have available my visible spectrum, this is nanometers for the wavelength, visible until the near infrared, let's say up to 900 nanometers, and then the detection efficiency drops to zero, right? This is covered by silicon devices. Silicon devices, again, have very high figure of merit because they can have a high efficiency, low dark counts, and so on, low noise. And on the other hand, if I switch to indium gallium arsenide, this is sort of a typical absorption spectrum of that detector, and it covers nicely the telecom range, starting from, let's say, 1,000 nanometer to 1,600, say, right? So it nicely covers the telecom, and you can have on the order of 25% detection efficiency in that range. So again, the problem, however, is that the indium gallium arsenide typically has less performance, right? It has noise issues, after pulsing is a big problem. So again, that's the trade-off in the lab we would have to face all the time. And then these emerging detector systems, such as superconducting ones I mentioned, are a big thing now. There's actually a couple of commercial systems now doing those nanowires. I think they are very, very promising for quantum communication. They can offer very high efficiency and by now, and also good timing resolution, so sub-nanosecond timing. Efficiency is up to 90% has actually been reported. Now, the big drawback of the superconducting ones is they're cryogenic. So they need operation at a few Kelvin, if not less than a Kelvin. And now if you think of the entirety of a QKD system, that puts a big limit, right? Because a cryogenic system is typically big, bulky, and also costly, right? So I guess that just means there's no really true optimum here. I guess that's the big message. Okay, the other big question is how can we generate the photons that we use in a QKD system? And so the ideal single photon generator would be some form of a quantum state, like an atom or something, which has two levels, right, excited and then decays from the excited by emitting a photon. And unfortunately, it's not quite that easy to obtain, it turns out, in the lab, right? So there are of course a lot of people who built single photon sources based on those atoms. So this is one example from this paper where they have a single atom stored in a cavity and drive it with a laser pulse, right? They collect the signals and then actually analyze them in two such APDs for the single photons. What they did here to characterize a single photon is what is called this Hambury-Brown twist experiment, HBT measurement. And this comes out in many, you'll find that in pretty much any paper which talks about photon sources, they will talk about this G2 measurement here. This is the second order correlation of the intensity. So what it does, it essentially measures the correlation inside a light beam, right? It measures the intensity correlation from one time to another time, right, T1, T2, and normalizes by those intensities. Now, why does it so give us a reading for a single photon, for the quality of a single photon source? That is that if I had a true single photon source, I would only ever get one photon per pulse, right? So I can never get two events, right? Now, at the single photon level, that would mean that this second order correlation if I let's say look at the outcome of one such beam, such a beam splitter, I can never get, if I have one photon come in, I can never get a correlation here and there, right? There will only be a detection here, either here or here. There's never going to be a joint detection. And what it also means is that the second order correlation function will actually be zero. For this example, for this stored ion, they showed that at my pulse, this is at zero, right? These are consecutive pulses. I truly ever get, the G2 is really zero. I only get one photon emitted, right? I never get two photons, so which will here show up as an event above the noise, right? So that is one good example of such a true single photon emitter. Now, however, what is the practical disadvantages of such a system would be typically the collection efficiency of a single atom or ion into an optical fiber is usually very low, right? It's always in the percent, in the range of a percent, right? So it's never really working very well. So this is another video paper. This is the one I mentioned about right at the beginning, talking about the explosion of papers in the field, right? They have it in this paper. And they, for instance, studied different types of single photon sources based on various systems, right? Atomic, or one could use two photon systems, or one can have quantum dots, single atoms, and so on. And they compared the main parameters. And one is, for example, this emission efficiency that I mentioned, right? What is a single photon gets emitted, what is the probability of actually capturing that photon, right? And you can see it actually all performs relatively, relatively speaking, not very well, right? However, they also measure the G2 to measure the qualitative sort of single photon mass, and there, of course, the single stored atom performed really well, and so would actually also parametric down conversion, which can be used to generate single photons. So now one way out for quantum key distribution is to use attenuated lasers. This is this weak coherent pulse idea. Now what is the idea here is, well, a coherent state typically is a superposition of Fock states, of photon states with a certain amplitude and phase, right? So generally speaking, what it means is that no matter what sort of average photon number the pulse will have, there will always be a sum of photon numbers, right? Now, if we say take a laser and attenuate it so that the average photon number is well less than one, right? That is often used as an approximation of a single photon. However, if I look at the numbers, simply taking this Poisson statistics here, which describes the distribution, the relative weights, I'll see that I get, with a probability of 0.9, I'll have no events, right? Zero photons. Probability of getting one photon will be 0.09, right? So it's very close to this 0.1. However, I'll also have two photons with a 0.05 probability, and so on, right? If I look at higher order terms. If I were to look at, let's say, 0.5 photons per pulse, I mean, just for example, I have 60% for zero, 30% for one, and 7% already for two photon events, and so on. Right? So it does make it tricky to generate a true single photon pulse. However, these types of sources are probably the most common ones used for QKD, just because of simplicity. I mean, having laser pulsed lasers is something that's very easy, and in many labs, can be done relatively easy, and also the lower cost and all that. This is one example of how this can be done out of this paper from Richard Hughes at Los Alamos. They have now the Alice transmitter, which has to generate those four polarization states, can use four different lasers, right? And each of them is aligned at a different polarization, and those laser pulses can be combined with optics, polarization optics, into one output coming out here. They also included a detector in there to calibrate the power, right? You have to make sure for QKD that even if you attenuate your laser pulse to 0.1 of a photon per pulse, one should always include, for practical purposes, a additional detector to characterize that and make sure that is in bounds. Otherwise, the system, of course, would be unsecure. If you suddenly emit 100 photons per pulse, which is still tiny power, if you think of actual energy, that would, of course, put the whole system at risk. The other scheme to do it would be to have one laser and some form of a modulator, but that is more difficult. Now, the problem of a laser pulse is that, and you can verify yourself, this is just from basic quantum optics, the G2 of a laser, of a coherent pulse, is always one. No matter how much you attenuate, there's always this ratio of finding one photon and another one is always going to be one. And this puts a system based on laser pulses at risk to the so-called number splitting attacks, right? An eavesdropper could, at least in principle, place a beam splitter right at the after the source, and split off some photons, do a measurement on those two photons, and if you have two photons available, the measurement eve can do is has better quality than the threshold, and then the eavesdropper could then say, okay, only take those two photon events, discard the others, and then make use of the transmission disk losses and put a transmitter right in front of Bob, let's say, or send a stronger pulse. So if the eavesdropper then makes use of the transmission, if let's say there's a 1% of transmittance of the channel, the eavesdropper could just use the, it just needs to have enough events coming out of Alice to create signals at Bob which follow that statistics, right? Just have enough events to overcome the transmission loss. And this is a huge problem, actually. However, a fix has been found, and that's the good news. It's based on what's called decoy states, such as it's 2004. This paper from the Holcomb Low Group in Toronto, actually, and there's been others as well. And what they do is they create signals such as in such a generator, which have different amplitudes. So Alice also chooses different photon number amplitudes. And then afterwards in the post-processing with those, so Alice and Bob can talk about the signal states and those so-called decoy states, which have a different amplitude, and then compare the relative arrival rates and success rates, and they will be able to tell if such an attack happened or not. Because the eavesdropper doesn't know how much intensity was transmitted, because it's always less than one photon on average, so it would have to be a statistical measure, but the single pulse cannot give enough statistics to get that out to the eavesdropper. So this is why this adds security to the system. So entangled photons, how do we generate them in the lab? So we define already those entangled states, and the best way, first I want to define how to measure entanglement and characterize it. So one way is to look at those correlation measurements, right? Such as if I have an entangled source, EPS, I have, let's say, polarization measurements with weighing plates and another set and a polarizer, and I can change different, look at different polarization angles, such as in the DARL, looking at those states, right? And then one can do what is often done is a quantum state tomography of that state, where by taking a whole range of measurements for different directions, based on the measurement outcomes, you can then reconstruct the density matrix of this entangled state. And a signature of the entanglement is to have these off-diagonal elements, right? because that they are a sign of the coherences. So these ones here, e to the I phi, or sorry, e to the I theta, right? And they're like important. I do want to point out there's a nice review about the tangle following generation and also measurements such as from Idamatsu in 2007. So methods to generate those entangled photons include so nonlinear optics such as second order or third order nonlinear optics. So this is three-wave mixing, and this would be four-wave mixing in an optical medium. And but there's also things such as quantum dots which can emit entangled photons. There's actually a lot of research now going on in this direction. Why? Because this could be like an on-demand type of entangled photon source. Atoms have been used to generate entangled photons. All of those systems are not very, so to say, practical. So the most practical, so to say, for QKD, so in total 10 minutes, yeah, is going to be this second order nonlinearity at the top, which we'll focus on. And so this it's based so basically called parametric down conversion, which was first noted by a Russian researcher Klushko in 1967 actually. That so at the time it was early days of lasers and also nonlinear optics. People did notice that one can do conversion of frequencies in optical media. However, he noticed that there should also be this quantum feature, which is this parametric down conversion, where under energy and momentum conservation that is satisfied, one can get a spontaneous emission of photon pairs. And it's called SPDC, so spontaneous parametric down conversion. So what happens is this chi2 medium here, second order nonlinearity, will sort of say mix three beams, right? The pump, one is called pump, signal, and idler. Now, if these ones are not populated, there's zero intensity, so then there's only the pump coming in. The quantum features of this nonlinear interaction will lead to a spontaneous emission of idler and signal photons, and they come pairwise. The really interesting feature is that this is a truly a quantum effect, right? In classical optics, one can also describe this interaction. It's been well known. However, if I just use classical EM, so to say, I can never get any signal on the idler signal output if there's no seeding input here, right? Now, in quantum mechanics, one way to see why quantum mechanics does create something is in quantum mechanics we have the vacuum fluctuations, right? So therefore, this operation is also often called amplified vacuum. It's also known as squeezing, right? Depending on which application is being used, and leads to the creation of those photon pairs. They become pairwise, the signal and idler. And typically they have a spectrum which corresponds to a sync function due to the way the phase matching works. So a typical entangled photon source, or the state of the art, would be the following one, which is often called a Sagnac loop. We have a nonlinear crystal in here, for example, periodic called KTP, where a blue pump laser comes in, and at this polarizer it gets split into equal portions, circling around this interferometer in different directions. So one side goes to the crystal, create a photon pair, and from the other side comes from this direction, creates a photon pair coming this way, right? However, the way this polarizer works out, and the half-wave plate here, half-wave plate, by the way, flips the polarization by 90 degrees. So that it splits out the photons. Photon pairs are created as a horizontal and a vertical photon. However, this polarizer will, if the photon pair comes from here, it will transmit a horizontal photon coming to Alice and a vertical photon going to Bob. Whereas if the pair creation happened along this way, then there will be a vertical photon that has to be reflected going to Alice and a horizontal photon going to Bob. And this leads to this entanglement. So Alice and Bob get this entanglement because whenever Alice has a photon, she doesn't know did it come from, so to say, this part of the loop or this direction of the loop, right? And this leads to the entanglement. And such a source can generate millions of photon pairs per second just from a few milliwatts of pump lasers. So they are very, very convenient. And there's a lot of different schemes and materials. This PPKDP that I mentioned is just one of those type of materials. Pump laser is a consideration, so actually I'll go over this one, but has to be optimized, so in the lab it's never quite as straightforward, right? So one big challenge is to overlap the beam modes of the pump, let's say, the beam waste and the down conversion, collected beam waste into an optical fiber. So there's a lot of optimization going on. These are the spot diameters. However, once the source is aligned and set up, it's actually quite convenient. The signal and idle wavelengths, for example, can be tuned by changing the temperature of the crystal. So that is also very nice, gives a lot of flexibility. This is such a source now, an actual photo. It's a little fuzzy, but the crystal would be here in this box. That's actually a heater, that's why it's enclosed. You can see the blue laser light coming in. The polarizer would be here. So this triangle here would be the main core Sagnac loop. And then we have fiber couplers here and there for collecting and capturing the photons into optical fiber. So there's other ways of doing it, but we have to go quicker now. And because we only have, I guess, a few minutes left, 5 minutes. Okay, beam splitters are very important. Now, if you think of it like on paper, beam split operations is quite straightforward, right? We have a certain set of operators which defines it. When you go to a vendor like or a company to buy beam splitters in the lab, there's like so many options. However, this is sort of typically what such a non-polarizing beam splitter cube looks like. It literally does look like a square of two prisms fused together. But so it's readily available. However, there has to be, in the lab, there's always a lot of considerations. Modulators are an important part of such a scheme for QKD. So in free space, one would have bulk modulators, which require high voltages, like kilovolts, to switch. In fiber-based QKD systems, one can use such modulators integrated. They just need a few volts for operation. And they are widely developed, or very, very well developed for telecom industry, right? So, however, for quantum, they have some disadvantage that typically their transmission losses are not that good. I mean, it's all good for telecom, but for us, every dB of transmission loss counts, right? As you saw, we don't have much margin. Quantum random numbers can be an important part. So a true QKD system would have a true random generator inside, right? And the best physical generator that we know of is based on quantum mechanics, because on using a simple quantum mechanics process, because if you think of this kind of beam splitter, the quantum superposition at its core is by itself a perfectly random situation, because this superposition can only show up if there's no other information, so to say, about the system in the rest of the universe, right, in exaggerated terms. So the systems can have been built by doing such a beam splitter operation, for example. So we had a nice paper a couple of years now already where we had a little light source, and we built a small contraption with a beam splitter and two photon detectors, and that gave the random signal. So this is how to test it. And these random numbers can also be, there's been recent work on building
true certified random numbers using Bell states and entanglement. And so finally, I wanted to show you some examples of implementations in fiber optics. There's always a trade-off for any lab system. You know, I have such a transmission, so detection, you know, I have absorption to consider, I have sources for my lasers to consider. So there's a whole kind of consideration. It really always depends what one wants to do. There's no clear answer. It always depends on the situation. So this is one example where we used entangled photons to send this image from Alice to Bob. And this was done over optical fiber. Here we actually did have those modulators and random numbers to generate the so we have electro-optic modulators and random numbers to generate Alice and Bob's settings. And we generated a few kilobits of secure key this way, right? This was done over a few hundred meters. And pretty much state of the art is in terms of transmission speed is this one, where this is by the group from Cambridge, where they implemented a very high-speed modulator system clocked at a gigahertz, and they have a phase modulator here to modulate those signals. Went over 50 kilometers of fiber, and then Bob also has a phase modulator inside an interferometer to do his measurement settings, and then we have single photon detectors. And however, now this is out of this paper, they show a rate of the final sifted key of a million bits per second, right? And that's still pretty much the top number that has been reached so far, right? So that gives a lot of times I'm asked how fast could QKD ever go, and so at the moment this is pretty much the top level, and limitations are not just the source and how fast the source can be modulated. A big limitation is the detection of signals, right? You have to detect the rates. Signals and also analyze them. Data processing at that rate also becomes a huge challenge because the amount of data generated and that has to be analyzed and communicated and processed is also really, really demanding to do truly secure transmission. So then we go, and for free space, now this will be the last three slides. Same story, I have to take my atmospheric sort of transmission and I have to do the same considerations, right? Now things are a little different. Absorption atmosphere is also better at longer wavelengths, but beam diffraction now is better at shorter wavelengths. And these are, it's kind of interesting, those two effects can cancel at some range. So that's why for free space, it's never that, there's not that much push to the 1550, right? It can also be very good at around 800 and so on, nanometers. And the current record for distance of entangled photons, for example, and also QKD, is this experiment on the Canary Islands, which I was also part of. And what we did is we sent from one island, from La Palma, from one of their observatories on the mountain, 140 kilometer over to Tenerife, to the another observatory near Taide, the mountain, the entangled photon. So this was the receiver station. It's actually by the European Space Agency, a 1 meter telescope. And at the transmitter, we used a self-built smaller optical system as the transmitter. And the entangled photons were generated nearby in a container lab. One photon detected on the island and the other one sent over to this 1 meter receiver and analyzed in there. And still after this transmission, we were able to, this is like a timing histogram to determine the single photons with a clear signature. And also we were able to violate the Bell inequality and get some secure key in the end. So finally, my final remark is, so what is the future of QKD? In terms of research, there's a lot of activity now to get device independent. What that means is, well, the QKD systems can be hacked because the devices have some loopholes, right? It's the implementation. So it's never that the security proofs are well established. One problem, challenge that we have now for implementations is that people like Vadim Makarov, for example, they would send, you know, strong laser pulses into detectors, and they can suddenly hijack the detector. And the eavesdropper was able, they showed literally that they could take the commercial system and send signals onto the detector and read out the key that way, or generate a key fully known to the eavesdropper, right? So what they're doing is they're exploiting implementation problems or loopholes. And one way out is to do a full loophole-free belt test on the system. Now that's very demanding and challenging, and I didn't speak about the problems there, but what it means is have entangled photons, send them to Alice and Bob, and they have to have very high overall system efficiency. It has to be on the order of 80%, and that's pretty much very, very demanding. And it's actually a full loophole-free belt test hasn't been achieved yet. There's at least one could do partial device independence using detect for the detectors, and there's actually a bit of research quite recently. There's been good research on this, showing that it is possible to ensure the security of the detectors at least, which are the most vulnerable system of a QKD. And then the other direction is, if we think of an internet, right, is that one day we'll be using satellites. I just go to this slide where, and I'll speak about that in the afternoon, where by using a quantum receiver, let's say on a satellite or a transmitter, I could, let's say, have a network around a city, which can be done with fiber, and one can use a satellite to bridge this long distance to another network around another city, say, across a continent or even across the globe, right? So satellites are one direction to reach global distances for the QKD. And this, in the end, will hopefully allow us one day to have a global quantum internet, right? So where we can send these quantum signals around from various devices, various stations at our will. So, okay, thank you very much. So this was my overview. Yeah. The satellites. So yeah, there's a lot of research also from various places. So the Chinese groups, they claim that next year they'll be launching a first system. So they claim 1 or 2 years they'll be up. So in Canada, we're working on this as well. But for us, it's maybe until we can actually have a satellite, it's more like 3, maybe 5 years even. So it's in the few years, say. But there's a lot of activity, so it's not a question of if it will happen, these satellites. It's just going to be a few years, and then we'll have this quantum transmissions to satellites.
So you were mentioning while transmitting photons through free space, you were encoding the photons in either the polarization degrees of freedom or as time degrees. You mentioned that the polarization degrees of freedom are very, very robust to
For free space, yeah. For free space. Yeah.
I didn't get why is that? Why is it?
So it turns out that the turbulence does not essentially not affect the polarization state. At least not at the level where we care about it. So. Why? In order to affect the polarization state, you need birefringence. You need something which has a different, let's say, propagation property for one polarization versus the other. Now, in optical medium like a glass, that can happen due to stress. Or in optical fiber, it happens just even the geometry from bending can already lead to different propagation of the different polarization. In atmosphere, the turbulence is due to refractive index change, but it's very minor. I mean, on a big scale, the difference of refraction, because why is that the case? Because difference of refractive index means you have more pressure or less pressure. And the air cannot, I mean, it will immediately, you know, equalize the pressure, right? So you can never have a large pressure difference. And that's why birefringence is very little. Actually, one of the early experiments they did with lasers was actually to test on a horizontal link. There's an early paper in the 60s checking the polarization properties of air. And they showed that it was literally below the measurement precision of their apparatus.
In one of your first slides, you've put quantum generators as a category by themselves, like quantum communication, quantum computing. And why is that?
It turns out that good sources of quantum of randomness is actually required for various applications even in secure communication, you need even if you have classical algorithms, you usually need a random generator as a initial source or some initial seed. And actually, there was a problem with one of the implementations of that random generator using an algorithm some years ago, right? Where they were doing a scheme implemented random generator in the algorithm was not as random as they thought, right? So that led to a security loophole. Or if an attacker could influence the random generator, if it's let's say a better one, but still could influence it, so that could also give a loophole. So for example, chip-based random generators, it has been shown that by changing the doping of the semiconductor, there could be a vulnerability. There was just a paper recently about that, where people showed that the semiconductor behaved perfectly right unless somebody would somehow send in certain sort of radiation, like electromagnetic radiation, and then change the properties of the semiconductor material, and then could bias the random generator on the chip, even, right? So that's why. Good randomness could be very useful for applications like in cryptography, but also in numerical sort of analysis, like Monte Carlo type analysis. Sometimes it could be interesting. Gambling.
Has it been shown that are there theoretical studies saying when a good random number generator would be better, or a quantum?
At least I know one paper where they compared that. They looked at randomness generated from algorithms and inbuilt functions like in C and so on, compared it to physical ones, and they did show that the quantumness can at some point at least, or let's put it that way, unless you have a really good algorithm, the algorithm can perform less good, right? So that they did. There's a PRA about that. I can give that or show that. The other one is, it depends, right? I mean, one is the quality of randomness, the other one is, can it be influenced or known, right? If you think of an algorithmic randomness, the problem is maybe if somebody somehow knows your initial seed values, then your randomness is predictable. It's not a randomness, You know what I mean? It's like, it's perfectly predictable because it's an algorithm. And physical generators, many use like the noise on a PN junction or something. That is typically a very complex thermal noise. And there, some correlations with a different system could be hidden, right? Because it's just so complex. And the quantum random number has a fundamental advantage that it exploits a basic fundamental sort of property like this quantum superposition, and there just the theory itself is very simple, and the mechanism is also very simple. So that's maybe the another advantage.
Yeah,
learn more from Thomas. Thank you very much for a very
Thank you. Thanks.